Kuzusampu, and a very good evening to all our viewers. This is BBS Channel 2 and your weekly dose of Buddhism, the Jangchub Shing. I am your host for the next 1 hour, Karma Dendrup. We would like to inform our viewers that should you miss any of our programs, now that we are 24/7, you can catch the programs the following day. For our program schedule, log on to our website, www.bbs.bt/bbs2. For those of you who are watching this program for the first time, what we do on this show is we discuss Buddhist truths in an effort to better comprehend the vast and timeless Buddha Dharma with Buddhist masters, practitioners, and scholars. The topic of our discussion tonight is an insight into Buddhist truths, and our guest speaker on this very special episode is His Eminence Dzongsar Jamyang Khyentse Rinpoche. A brief biography on Rinpoche. We know His Eminence Dzongsar Jamyang Khyentse, the filmmaker of simple and profound films like The Cup, Travelers and Magicians, which was filmed with an all-Bhutanese cast within the country, and more recently of Vara, The Blessing, which was screened at the City Mall in the capital. And we know that His Eminence also writes books like What Makes You Not a Buddhist and other books which translates into words the realization that is otherwise wordless and indefinable. We know that His Eminence is an incarnate Lama, but what do we know about His past incarnations? The Jangchub Shing research team was able to compile from the World Wide Web a short biography of Rinpoche. They were able to draw a few drops from the limitless ocean of wisdom that is the legacy of the Khyentse lineage. In the year 1820, the seed of the Khyentse lineage came into being with the birth of the first Khyentse, Jamyang Khyentse the Great. He grew to be a scholar, mystic, author, and meditator par excellence. In his youth, he traveled all over Tibet, receiving innumerable spiritual teachings, including lineages that were almost extinct. The first Khyentse was known to have studied with over 150 of the greatest Buddhist masters of his time. In his late 30s, he retired to a small room in the Sakya monastery of Dzongsar, near Derge in eastern Tibet, where for the remainder of his life he practiced and mastered the teachings he had received. In many cases, he revived the lineage, writing commentaries and passing on the instructions to individuals capable of holding them. He was regarded as the last of the five Tirthan kings who were prophesied by Guru Padmasambhava in the 9th century. His collected works consist of 35 volumes covering all aspects of mysticism and scholarship. He was an authority on all the different teachings of Buddhism in Tibet, as well as the pre-Buddhist Bon teachings. Shunning sectarian bias, he encouraged his students to appreciate the profundity of all the existing traditions. This approach became known as Rime, or the non-sectarian approach. He passed away in 1892, predicting that he would reincarnate in several forms. Born in 1894, Dzongsar Khyentse Rinpoche was recognized as one of the incarnations of Jamyang Khyentse Wangpo and acquired his name as he took responsibility for Dzongsar Monastery.
Everybody respects not only one tradition, but every tradition. There are very few lamas who receives the respect from every tradition.
Jamyang Khyentse Wangpo, think these things. Then he collected this very important tradition. He went to many places, then received these one and teeth from many lamas, then collected together. So that is very, very getting Jimbo.
Like his predecessor, he received teachings from a wide variety of teachers and held and propagated many lineages of meditation practice. He greatly expanded Kamje College, and under his guidance, Dzongsar Monastery became a great center of learning. Almost all of the great lamas of the Nyingma, Kagyu and Sakya traditions of that generation received teachings from this outstanding master. In the 1950s, Dzongsar Khyentse Rinpoche settled in Sikkim, where he became the guru of the royal family, residing at the palace monastery until he passed away in 1959.
I remember when my master passed away, you know, one thought that came to me was that, you know, that had it not been for you, how could I possibly understand? He gives you the understanding to understand yourself, understand world, understand life, really. So it's kind of it's the most precious, really.
His Eminence Dzongsar Jamyang Khyentse Rinpoche, Thubten Chögyi Jamso, was born in 1961 in Bhutan and was recognized as the mind emanation of Jamyang Khyentse Chöki Lodro. The Khyentse lineage has always been characterized by the vision of non-sectarianism. Reflecting this tradition, His Eminence Dzongsar Khyentse Rinpoche studied with teachers from all the four schools of Tibetan Buddhism. Rinpoche received empowerments and teachings from many of the greatest contemporary masters, including the 14th Dalai Lama, His Eminence the 16th Karmapa, His Eminence Sakya Trizin, and his own grandfathers, His Eminence Dujum Rinpoche and Trupthop Sonam Zangbo. His main guru was His Eminence Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche. Rinpoche further studied with more than 25 great lamas from all four schools of Tibetan Buddhism. While still a teenager, Rinpoche was responsible for publishing many rare texts that were in danger of being lost entirely, and in the 1980s began the restoration of Dzongsar Monastery in Tibet. He has established many colleges and retreat centers in India and in Bhutan. In accordance with the wishes of his teachers, Rinpoche has traveled and taught throughout the world, establishing Dharma centers in Australia, Europe, North America, and Asia. In 1989, His Eminence Dzongsar Khyentse Rinpoche founded Siddhartha's Intent, a worldwide association of Buddhist centers whose principal intention is preserving the Buddhist teachings as well as deepening the understanding and awareness of the many aspects of the Buddhist teachings across different cultures and traditions. In 2001, Rinpoche also founded the Khyentse Foundation, a non-profit organization aiming to function as a system of patronage for institutions and individuals engaged in the practice and study of the Buddha's wisdom and compassion. Rinpoche also founded Lotus Outreach, a non-profit organization dedicated to ensuring the education, health and safety of women and children at risk in the developing world. Dzongsar Khyentse Rinpoche is also the director of Deer Park, Centers of Art and Contemplation in Bhutan and India, of the World Peace VAS program, a major worldwide initiative of His Eminence Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche, and of the Siddhartha School in Australia. In 2008, Rinpoche founded the Manju Gosha edition, based in Berlin in Germany, to publish rare and precious Buddhist texts on demand. Rinpoche, in his avatar as a filmmaker, has directed three major motion pictures: The Cup in 1999, Travelers and Magicians in 2003, and in 2013, Vara, the Blessing. He is also the author of the book What Makes You Not a Buddhist? a book that cuts through the maze of Buddhist culturalism and strips the Buddhist world of its labels and concepts. It is Jangchub Shing's honor and privilege that Rinpoche graciously accepted our request for an interview and made time for us, and in doing so, enriched our show and our lives. Without further ado, we bring to you His Eminence, Dzongsar Jamyang Khyentse. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Since given the fact that there is never enough time to discuss Buddhist truths and there is no such thing as a short answer, I will straight away go to my first question. My first question to Rinpoche is, like our signature tune which plays at the beginning of our show, is who is the Buddha?
This is a very important question, and as you put it very rightly, requires a lot of time to explain this. But it is, since it's a very important and personal. When we mention Buddha, we can't help but think in terms of a historical figure who was born in a place called Lumbini as a prince, and then he left his palace and seeking for the truth, finding the truth, he achieved what we call nirvana, which is basically actualizing the truth, and deciding to share that method with the rest of the people. And by doing so, he went to Varanasi, and there he taught the first sermon. And unlike immortal beings, he was passed into the parinirvana in a place called Kushinagar. So this is a historical sort of figure. Now, in Buddhism, especially in the Mahayana Buddhism, the Buddha is none other than our own ultimate innate nature, which exists is probably not the right word, but it is there. Like when you see a water, there is moisture. You cannot separate water and moisture. When you see a fire, you cannot separate fire and the heat. Sort of the innate ingredient, if you like, innate nature of the being, not just human being, butterfly, mosquitoes, tigers, all beings have that nature, and that is essentially the real Buddha.
Plus, a follow-up question on this would be, the reason I ask this is because I had the good fortune of being in the audience when His Holiness the Dalai Lama was speaking. And His Holiness began the talk by saying, "Sang asa sang ragata ka gayata jasa je." So is it, like Rinpoche mentioned, for us also, starting from the very word itself, that we should analyze what it means so that it benefits us, and to be on a constant check on ourselves also, that...
Definitely, and that is the quintessence of so-called the Buddhist practice, to really actualize. For right now, most of us, we are only using probably like the sort of the 1,000th, probably the millionth capacity of ourselves. There's so much capacity, there's so much potential. And that need to be tapped into, that need to be actualized. So, so-called chedumni, practicing the Dharma, is really to recognize it. Upon recognizing it, maintaining that recognition, strengthening that recognition, and not just to just for oneself, but also making all the other beings, helping them to understand that nature.
My next question to Rinpoche is, although the 84,000 volumes make up the Buddha's word and commentaries on his timeless Dharma, would Rinpoche be so kind as to share with the viewers a condensed essence of what they express?
Well, since everybody likes to hear in a form of category, I would say, I could sort of safely say, all 84,000 teachings of the Buddha, in fact more, you can sort of categorize them into three categories, which we call lapasum. So it's a discipline, basically. It is a discipline of discipline, and then discipline of meditation, and then discipline of wisdom. So these are the three disciplines, mainly all the teachings consist these teachings. So when we talk about wisdom, we are talking about what really lies behind all this facade of appearance. Because when we interact with the world, we are always interacting with what we usually see and what we hear, not what is there, what it is, sort of, the actual truth. So to deal with, Buddha taught so many wisdom teachings, such as Prajnaparamita, Madhyamika, etc. And you need a discipline of discipline to maintain that recognition, to understand that, not just the recognition, to understand that, to establish the understanding. So for that, hearing, contemplation, so on and so on. So this is why the discipline of the discipline, which involves like shaving your hair, not for everyone. Monks' discipline, nuns' discipline, you know, semi-monks' discipline, lay people's discipline. So there's all kinds of disciplines, like even as minute as how to wash your hand, how to walk. And then there's the meditation, which is really gearing towards understanding the truth. It is really not for mere combating the stress, as that's how it is, seems to be sounding. You know, like nowadays the meditation has become very popular. So we have all this like Uma resort meditation, Aman resort meditation, so which are all really looking forward to some sort of a stress-free situation. But in Buddhism, it's much more than that. It's far beyond than that.
Labasum, the three discipline. And these disciplines, my naive mind is not misconceiving it, is Rinpoche sharing with us that there is these are means to an end, and the end being nirvana, and not that they themselves, because there is another saying which says gomba in, as in like to make the practice itself to be accustomed to the practice.
Very good. That's the point. So like, you know, when you go to the other shore, you take a boat. But the boat is just means, it's not the destination. If you go to Thimphu, the road to Thimphu is important. That's the only way to reach Thimphu, but that is not Thimphu. Likewise, means are means, I mean, as the word says. And this is an important question, because many of us, we get so stuck with means, so much so that we actually forget the destination.
My next question to Rinpoche again is contentment. And the tricky word for it is chokshe. As Rinpoche actively commissions and translates Buddhist teachings to the English language, does the English word contentment perfectly define the word chokshe? And what did the Buddha have to express on contentment?
I believe so, the contentment. I believe so. But although chokshe is such a profound word, it is a noble wealth. It is an amazing wealth. People don't know that this is probably the only viable key to the wealth. I mean, spiritual wealth, emotional wealth, material even. When a human being thinks, I have enough, he or she is already rich. When you are not thinking in that term, no matter how much you have, you will never be a rich. So in that spirit, the chokshe I guess the word contentment is translating that to a certain extent.
Yes, yes. And that is what the Buddha had to share about contentment.
Very much. This is actually one of his important pith instructions, not just for the monks, even for the lay people.
Yes. And contentment not just in terms of, Rinpoche was so kind to share that, not just in terms of wealth, but in terms of knowledge and acquiring of wisdom as well.
Everything. Because at the end of the day, there is no such thing as perfections in the imperfect world.
Yes.
So, yes. Contentment is absolutely necessary.
Yes. The reason I ask that question, because although one would feel that when it comes to acquiring of wisdom, you cannot put contentment there, but given the Kali Yuga or the span of our lives, I was thinking that sometimes maybe we need to pat yourself on your back also and be like, okay.
Oh, I see. No, that, as many followers, such as the great Jingmeling, perhaps said, for the practitioners, the practitioners needs two kinds of, attitude. One is humility. I don't know enough. You know, that humility, really genuine, pure humility. The other is what I have is good enough. You know, so these two really are quite important to balance out. Otherwise, many times, in the midst of all this practice of humility, one could discourage ourselves and lose our self-esteem and so on and so forth.
I get scared to ask this question, and I've asked it to His Eminence Sogyal Rinpoche and Dr. Robert Thurman, who will be airing tonight in my slot. But I have to venture into it. It's Rinpoche Tongba Nyila. And shunyata, and in English, emptiness. Although I fear that there might not be a short answer, as I just mentioned, for this timeless philosophy or truth, if Rinpoche would simplify it for us.
Okay. If I try to be more meticulous, I think the word "ness," which comes after empty, that is quite an important one. Because it's defining something. And emptiness, it's a quality. When you talk about a quality, then you are always talking about something. And when you are talking about something, you are not really talking about empty. So there is that. It's not a contradiction, but there is this paradoxy. Now, practically speaking, emptiness can be sort of approached. Let's put this example. When we are looking at a rainbow, it's beautiful, it's intact, it's always orderly. There's no such thing as barrow rainbow starts with blue, and then New York starts with the purple, so on and so forth, right? There's that order. And when the cause and conditions are there, the sunlight, the bit of a rain, and also, a person, looking at it, because if there's a rainbow somewhere in the middle of nowhere, there is no rainbow. You have to have a perceiver. And also the distance. If you're too close, you don't see. Now, rainbow is so beautiful, but none of this makes the rainbow exist substantially. So rainbow does not exist substantially. But that does not mean that you don't see rainbow when the cause and conditions are there. So there is this very beautiful harmony between the appearance and the emptiness. Yes. It's not like appearance comes first and emptiness comes later.
Yes.
It's not also the otherwise.
Yes.
And that probably is one way to approach to the understanding of emptiness. But as you put it, it is not something that we could intellectualize. And I mean, of course, you can have a glimpse of idea of what we are talking about, but most of it will have to happen through the meditation.
Yes. And just like a short follow-up on this question, because I was in discussion with Dr. Bob Thurman, we came into this talk about by the relative truth and then the ultimate truth. Mm-hmm. So as Rinpoche shared with us about the phenomena of rainbow, yes, and then the perceiver watching it, is it for me to benefit from this philosophy, although the me and all of that also comes into question when you're discussing emptiness, is the observation of emptiness subjectively, should there be a thought in my head, as in whenever I look at in any direction or all sound that I perceive, that I have that understanding that, oh, in its essence, that it's empty?
Right. Okay. You're touching a very big point now. As one of the great Mahasandhi Mahasandhi, Dzogchen Rinpoche Master said, as long as there is notion that this is it, it is never it. So as long as you have a definition, and as long as you are, what do you call it? As long as there is something that you're pointing, then it's never the it, because it's subjective. Yes. Now you were talking about a relative. Relative truth is very important. Relative truth and ultimate truth are never separated. Yes. These two are so important. And it's so important that people know that Buddhism never rejects relative truth. And that's so important. I stress this because many of the Western Buddhists now don't seem to really appreciate. So this is why if you go to some of the Western countries, they will try not to talk about like reincarnation. Because, okay, they're Buddhist, but then they think, oh, the reincarnation is a bit like taboo and it's a bit very Tibetan superstition. It's not really scientific. This shows they have no understanding of relative truth. Reincarnation exists just as how you have a head on your neck. It's relatively true. Ultimately, you don't have a neck, you don't have a head, and there are form as emptiness and emptiness as form, etc.
Thank you, Rinpoche. Rinpoche, the law or the truth of karma, what would Rinpoche share with us on this amazing insight of the Buddha, and how is it different from, say, the Hindu belief of karma, or is it the same?
Karma fundamentally is a teaching of Tendal. And one could say it is the teaching of the Tendal dependent arising that made Buddha so special. He excelled from the other teachers. You have to think about this. We are talking about 2,500 years ago, somebody is talking very scientifically, while everybody is busy talking about Almighty, still people are talking about it. Or nothing exists. You know, going to these two extremes. There was a guy called Buddha 2,500 years ago. So it is a very, very sophisticated thinking. Now, karma, of course, simply it is a cause and condition. If there's no obstacle, the result is guaranteed, right? So that. Now, I'm not so sure about Hinduism. Hinduism is very complex. But one get this idea that Hindus' explanation the karma is kind of fixed. Like, you do whatever, good deeds, bad deeds, but it's the God who decides what you will go through, the consequences. So God is the boss, always. Whereas in Buddhism, you are your own boss. Nobody is your boss. So from this point of view, the Buddhist karma is different.
Rinpoche touched upon Tendre. And that was one of the questions that I wanted to ask Rinpoche. Rinpoche, Tendre, the truth of interdependence, if interdependence or interrelation, I'm not quite sure, if Rinpoche would be so kind as to share something on that, as my limited reading and study of it has confused me more than cleared it for me.
Actually, teaching of the Tendal is a teaching of emptiness. When you talk about the Tendal, dependent arising, you have no choice but to talk about emptiness. See, okay, talking more in a layperson's language. Cause, condition, and the result. That much, even the scientists talk about. You know, then, you know, we really dig in, you know, like, what's made, you know, what's the cause of this? And then we can go on, and you know, like the scientists could come up with all sorts of theory, you know, findings through laboratory and all of that. But the original cause, right? The original, the molecule, the atom, whatever, this is where religious people go one side. So they bring gods. No other choice, right? They bring the gods. In Buddhism, there is no such thing as original cause. Shunyata, emptiness. If you think there is an original cause, it is you who is doing it now. Just as you must be thinking that I'm right in front of you, and it's your thinking.
Rinpoche, my next question is, again, there are no small questions and there are no short answers. Deshik Nyingbola, Buddha nature, would Rinpoche be so kind as to share with us what we are to understand from the statement that all sentient beings possess the Buddha nature? For while it gives us hope in one hand, like the yogi of all yogis, Milarepa, one tends to get complacent with this profound term as well.
Right. Yeah. Well, earlier I was talking about there is no such thing as separation between water and moisture. When water is, its biggest ingredient is the moisture. But having said that, we are looking at the river, but we don't get wet. So in a way, there is a little bit of, separation. Now, you and I, people here, we don't remotely look like what we call Buddha. Right? We have this strange ideas like Buddha has to look like this. Most of the time it's always made, painted by, some painters or whatever, kundas, all that. According to the Buddha Dharma, okay, just I'll try to answer your question. The Buddha nature is fundamentally, we have all these defilements like anger, the jealousy, the pride, whatever. All these are destroyable. They are not innate nature. They are removable. What does that prove? That proves that they are, they are advantageous?
Advantageous.
Yes. They are not part of you. Okay, now, hypothetically, so what is there? We have to come up with a name. Yes. And that's called Buddha nature.
The one which is minus all of this?
Yes. And the minus all of this is the big plus. It is the jhanas, the kayas, the buddhas.
It's not a question that I had mailed to Rinpoche, but I can't help but ask this because our next show we are going to be discussing with Akempo about the five wisdom buddhas. And he touched upon the fact that these five poisons which Rinpoche was speaking about, the jealousy, the pride and all of that, them actually being wisdom when one recognizes them. So is anything that Rinpoche can share on that?
Well, again, I'll use just an ordinary example. Zodiac sign?
Yes.
Like Gemini, for instance, I'm Gemini. What are you?
I'm Cancer.
Right. So Cancer has, negative trait and then positive, the good side. But if you look at carefully, the negative is the positive, isn't it? For instance, like I was told, like Gemini's negative is, tend to see both sides. But that's good too. But it could be bad because you never really have a direction. You change your mind all the time, you understand? So, depending on how you use. So, there you go, just like that, anger. If you don't know how to use it, it is that destructive, that terrible aggression thing. But it is also what we call mirror-like wisdom, melong tabi yeshe. So that depends on how you handle. So when we talk about the five wisdom, we are talking about Mahayana and especially the Vajrayana. So this is a bit complicated.
This show, although whenever it goes on air, we normally go live and we take in callers also. And they ask, even starting from very simple Buddhists, like if they don't know what Tisum Sangye means also, we try to have the Khyentse explain that. So whenever this show goes on air, we have people calling in, and one very popular question is if there is a shortcut to Nirvana. And if there is, if Rinpoche would be so kind as to share it with us.
Yes, there is. And there's many, not just one. So much. And I shall share to all the viewers, the shortcut to Nirvana is they should seek for it. And that, if they seek for it, and actually seeking is more important than finding, they should really spend time on seeking.
Another thing about this program is the fact that it is, although once it goes on air, anybody can watch it from old to young, and on Facebook also our followers, people who follow this show are from a spectrum of age groups. But it is specifically aimed at the youth of Bhutan. And the youth of Bhutan, including myself growing up here, although it was so much more easier for me now in retrospect because we did not have the internet then and we did not have cable television then. So I feel that there is so much happening, and the fact that there is unemployment, all of these things, it's culminating to the youth. There is a higher case of depression and there is a higher case of suicide as well. So if there is any message from Rinpoche specifically to the youth of Bhutan.
I don't want to, I'm very tempted, but I have to say, I don't want to be so arrogant to sort of indicating that I know the answer, because I myself, I'm very puzzled in one way, and on the other hand, there must be so many reasons. And there must be so many cause and conditions. Small things like how we segregate these people, how we kind of, neglect these people in many different ways. Neglect comes in many different forms and, shapes, I think there's so many, many situations. I think even situations such as the fact that we are sandwiched between two giants is not helping us. But some of these situations, we just have to live with it. And therefore, I would say to the younger generations that they have to be patient. And our education system probably is a bit backward, and we are not really managing to, we are forgetting to teach our young generations that getting education is the primary reason is not to get a job, it's to really refine yourself, to be confident, to be creative, to be special. Many times going to schools, going to college, getting a job, not so special. It's just everybody does this. And it's something that British taught to Indians, and the Indians have now taught to us, and we are following that. It's nothing special, you know. So there's that. And there also, there's so much comparison. I feel for the young people. I feel for girls. I feel for boys. There's so much pressure to look like Korean boys, look like Japanese girls, look like, I don't know, Beyonce, look like Tom Cruise. I don't know, I'm far behind. I don't know who's the hottest guy or girl now. But there is that pressure. The magazines, the Facebook, the WeChats, and they're going to, they're to stay now. The other day I was watching BBS, and there was a really group of three singers. They were singing.
Yes, sir. Music Spotlight on the weekly show. That
and you know, the musician was sort of telling the young people that it's really good to volunteer. That's it. There we go. That's another one. You know, we have been told, we have been sort of groomed to think that, you know, only good, you know, sort of only worthwhile and valuable way of living is when you draw a salary. Stuff like that. You know, we need to change. We need to really make the people, you know, like, if our young generations go to remote places and help plant trees, plant vegetables, so that we don't have to buy from outside. And the satisfaction of having done that, probably it's so much more than cash. And this is something that we could maybe introduce and see. As I said earlier, I don't want to be, although I'm tempted, I don't want to be so arrogant to say that I have the answer for this. This is, of course, definitely a growing concern for me. And it's not going to get better. I'm sorry to be very pessimistic. I'm by nature a little bit pessimistic. The fact that you are asking me this question, and the fact that we are discussing this, I think that's quite good. I think we should discuss this more.
Yes, before my final question, this was about the youth. And another thing is, like, maybe a consolation or any words that Rinpoche could share with not just the parents, but even the relatives and siblings of people who have, because when I put this post online saying that I'll be interviewing Rinpoche, one of the questions that one of the viewers had was about what advice or what consolation can Rinpoche offer to the parents who have maybe lost a loved one to maybe suicide.
Of course, as a Buddhist, struggling, practicing Buddhist, I have my prayers, I have my sympathy for them. From the more mundane point of view, they're lost. Let us all use it so that we learn something, so that our future generations will not be complacent and learn from these losses. And then make our society better. And who knows? Maybe some of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas may be manifesting to teach us something. Because we are so thick and we are so complacent and we are so comfortable in a certain zone that we need a wake-up call. So I would express to all the loved, those who have lost their loved ones, hopefully that those who have lost their lives will wake us up.
Finally, Lord Rinpoche, although everything that Rinpoche shared with us could be used as a daily sadhana for us, but specifically, is there like a daily sadhana or method that Rinpoche would share with the viewers which we can incorporate in our daily lives?
This might sound too abstract, but I think it is quite important, and if you call it a sadhana, why not? But I would ask people, when they do whatever, brush their teeth, drink a cup of tea, or I don't know what they do, you know, whatever they do, wipe their face with towel, boil an egg, whatever they do, I would ask them for 1 minute if they could contemplate and do just that. When they drink tea, just drink tea and contemplate on that taste, the aroma, the strength, the heat or the cold, whatever, that contemplation. We are not contemplating enough. When we don't contemplate, we are nothing but a robot. And what is a robot? Ultimately, you are a slave, because somebody has to press the button, and people will press the button, and people will take advantage of you, knowingly, unknowingly, consciously, unconsciously. All this, you know, I don't know, Prada, Prado, whatever, all those manufacturers, they will press your button. So I would request people to contemplate. And I'm not even talking about some religious contemplation. Just whatever you are doing, just contemplate on that.
But anything that Rinpoche would like to share, like a closing remark, because I'm done with my questions.
Oh. Our generation, this juncture of Bhutan and Bhutan is so important, I think. Our culture, identity, sovereignty, humor, elegance. You know, we have so much elegance. Where we wear kira, where we put on our gauze. Even though I would, you know, from many different point of view, it could be the most clumsy thing to wear. You know, the whole world is trying to flatten their stomach, and here we go, look at the Bhutanese man, everything's, you know, bulky. But, you know, the elegance, it proves the goal, proves the elegance is inside, right? So like that, the elegance, the humor, harmony, kindness, this is a, we are in a, some sort of a junction, we are in a, some sort of a very important turning point, this generation. We, as a Bhutanese, we have, I think, 10 years, not anymore, I think less, but I want to be more optimistic. I think we have 10 years. And let's try to sort of do something in these 10 years. Let's try to do something or not do also. You know, a lot of time. That's my, I think that's all I can think of at the moment. Okay.
In closing, BBS Channel 2 would like to thank all our viewers, and we would also like to convey our deepest gratitude to Rinpoche for making time for us and fitting us within your tight schedule. I'd also like to remind you again that there is an email account, jangchubshing@bbs.bt, where you can send us your questions and feedback, and we will also ask your questions as and when we host our show. We are also on Facebook, just search for Jangchub Shing, and don't stop yourself from liking or sharing our page and posts. A final reminder to all our viewers, as expressed by His Eminence Sogyal Rinpoche and other guests on the show and Rinpoche today, to sum up the essence of what the Buddha taught, Dikpachi Amachashi Gyawapinsam Soparashi Rangi Semni Yonsudhiti Sangi Tembayi, to commit not a single non-virtuous act, commit as many virtuous acts as possible, tame your mind and you're a Buddha. We are 24/7 now, so stay tuned. From the production team here and everybody at BBS Channel 2, thank you for watching, take care, and don't forget our Jangchub Shing slogan, analyze and realize. Thank you for watching.